go to the upcoming board meetings on November the 14th, 2016, regular meeting at Minton Elementary at 6:30 p.m. December the 12th, 2016, regular meeting at Minton Elementary at 6:30 p.m. And January the 16th, 2017, regular meeting at the Burkett Educational Center at 6:30 p.m. At this time, I will turn it over to Mr. Boggs with Spotlight on the Valley.
Thank you, David. And we always like to take a few minutes and introduce our new employees, folks that will be recommended to the board tonight to be hired. And I see at least a couple here. Jenny Moriarty is being recommended as the high school track coach. Anything you'd like to share with us, Jen?
I'm really excited. I think it's going to be challenging, but I'm definitely up for it. We've got a great staff I'm hoping to be building. Some returning and some new, so I'm excited for that.
Now, you've got some background. I know you ran cross-country at Valley Track as well.
Yes.
And then some things at college, too?
Yes, I ran cross-country and indoor-outdoor track at Grace College.
Okay, Grace.
Yes.
Now, how many kids do you have?
Myself?
Yeah.
Three.
Yeah. How old are they now?
My youngest will be five. He's four. He goes to preschool here. And then Grady is in the third grade. He's eight, almost nine. And Molly just turned 12, and she's sixth grade. So I got her out running cross country this year because I helped the middle school this year. So made him run a lot.
Thanks for coming. I'm glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Welcome aboard.
David Ann Wilder. David is the new head custodian here at Minton.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself, David. I don't think probably too many of us are very familiar with you.
Okay. I've lived in Minton for about 10 years now. I originally went to WICCO, graduated, coached by Bill Patrick back in the day. And always respected Tippecanoe Valley football program that they had when I was growing up. Took advantage of us many times over the years. Charlie Smith, I remember one year at donuts and milk after the victory that day. So, but we love the area and really enjoying working here and have been welcome so much and just really like it.
Yeah. Do you live here in Minton?
Yes.
Okay. And somebody told you that is it your wife that owns the bookstore?
No, my daughter's.
Your daughter?
My oldest daughter's. Too.
Owns the bookstore.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, welcome. We're glad you're here.
Thank you. Really.
Have I missed anyone? It's a new employee for us tonight. Okay, that's it for that. We want the next one?
Oh, yeah. Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation recognition by the Riley Children's Foundation.
Yeah, we'd like to celebrate tonight, at least share with the public, that the Riley Children's Foundation recently recognized the school corporation for achieving what they call Riley Corporation status. During the 2015-16 school year. And basically what that means is that we're recognized for cumulatively raising at least $1 per student enrolled in the school corporation from participating schools. Obviously those dollars are used to support the kids and the families at Riley. And this is the certificate that we received from them. So, just think that reflects very well on our kids, our staff, family, community, a lot of very giving people that help support what's going on at Riley. And it was, I think, just a little bit ironic at the time that we received this. We had three kids at Riley at that time, or two that current students and one that was a past student at Riley. So I think that helped reinforce how important that is for us to do that. So I'd like to congratulate all our schools on that. And then we also, the middle school, received some recognition here by the Indiana Department of Education. And I don't know, Scott's here. You want to talk about that, Scott, what that was all about?
Yeah. We participate in the focus and priority group through a principal's leadership group. And so we submitted things we're doing to help kids be successful in our school buildings within that group. And one thing we do is called Ketchup Cafe. Basically, it's a missing assignment list, and if students have missing work, they grab their lunch and they go down to the study hall room, the area we call the cafe, and they do their work. If they get it done, they go back to lunch with their friends. If they don't, they go back the next day until they get caught up. So it's just sort of a catch to give another location within the school day to help keep kids caught up. We kept some data on it last year, and had a tremendous amount of homework get done during that time and assignments get turned in by kids, so we feel like it's being effective. it's not the only thing we do, but it's just one of the pieces that we use to try to make sure kids are staying caught up and successful in passing classes. So it was nice to get the recognition from the state, but this is something that we submitted through that priority group, so.
Couple of documents that they're submitting. Okay, thank you. And then we do try to take each board meeting and do a focus on student achievement. And I believe tonight, Mr. Cowley's going to talk about a book study that's being done, and I am part of that.
A few years ago, we began this journey on professional learning communities within our school corporation. And you can go ahead and start the second slide. We have 16 teachers, and then our administrators, and then our instructional coaches working on a book study. It's called Overcoming the Achievement Gap Trap, Liberating Mindsets to Affect Change. And the author is a gentleman named Dr. Anthony Muhammad, who is a part of Solution Tree. And we have spent a lot of time with him in the summers in terms of listening to him speak, implementing some of the things that he has been talking about to raise student achievement. And I've broken down where teachers and our instructional coaches, so we've got 27 people there that are working on this book study throughout the year. We've had our first meeting over the first couple chapters, and if you want to move forward. This started back in 2014 with our instructional coaches going to the first conference and bringing that back. We've had 45 teachers who have taken about 4 days in the summertime and gone to the PLC conference. So we wanted to follow up and support those folks as they are implementing the PLC process within the buildings. So we felt like using our ESL situation that we have here, using grant funding that we get from the state to purchase these books, and we knew that the teachings that we would learn from it really fit us here at Tippecanoe Valley. So these first couple chapters, we really focused on, if you want to move forward, the poverty situation that we have here. This was a quote from the book, 91% of Americans polled in 1965 believed that helping the poor was a top government priority. There was a research poll in 2012 that reveals only 52% of Americans polled felt that helping the poor was a top priority. Now, as a school corporation, we need to make sure that our teachers all feel that we have to help all kids. We're pulling the rope in the same direction because, you know, we are a microcosm of society. We have to address this within our professional learning communities. And then with our EL students, our English learners, the history of immigration in the United States has always culminated with full integration into society through English replacing the indigenous language. This was the case with the Polish, Italians, French, Germans, and all other non-English speaking immigrants. That's what we're addressing as a school corporation with our students who are coming here learning English. Now, we had over 30% of our students test out of or become fluent in English last year. So we feel like we're doing a really good job with our kids in addressing their needs. Now, to become proficient in the eyes of the state, our students have to score a level 5 on a WIDA access test that they take in January, February. So we moved those kids out of the program, and our numbers have decreased because we're meeting their needs. But we also know that it takes about 5 to 6 years for someone who doesn't speak English at all to become proficient. When we get students who are kindergartners that come in and they don't speak any English, they pass our third grade statewide test for the reading, the iRead. We get those kids to pass. So they're achieving what they need to do when we get here, when they come here as new citizens. So I think that this is reaffirming in terms of what we're doing as a school corporation, but we've got these 27 folks that I want you guys to know that they're spending extra time continuing to be lifelong learners, really focusing on what our mission is here and doing this. So kudos to them, and we will continue to update you on as we continue with this book study. What questions do you have?
It's amazing it's that much difference from them to that. Mm-hmm. Crazy.
Thanks, Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
That's it. This time we'll go to item C, items from the visitors. If there's anybody that has items, please stand, give your name. Hearing none, we'll move to the approval of the consent agenda. Item 1, approve the minutes of the September 12, 2016 regular meeting and executive session. Item 2, approve the minutes of the September 22, 2016 special meeting and executive session. Item 3, approve the hiring of the following personnel: April Jones, instructional assistant, Mentone Elementary; David Anwaller, head custodian, Mentone Elementary; Mary Loving, cook, Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Tracy Murphy, instructional assistant at Akron Elementary; Linda Tucker, instructional assistant at the Burkett Educational Center; Melanie Rockhill, sixth grade girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Haley Cooper, sixth grade girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Jenny Moriarty, head track coach at Tippecanoe Valley High School; and Todd Volk, junior varsity girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley High School. Item 4, accept the resignation of the following personnel: Todd Volk, seventh grade girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Sydney Reed, sixth grade girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Kaylee Gass, sixth grade girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Amy Rogers, instructional assistant at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School; Jennifer Mann, instructional assistant at Akron Elementary; and Juanita Estep, part-time custodian at Mentone Elementary. Item 5, approve maternity leave request for the following personnel: Paige Miller, third grade teacher at Mentone Elementary. Item 6, approve the overnight trip to the Tippecanoe Valley High School Student Council. And item 7, approve the overnight trip for the FFA. Are there any items that the board would like to pull up? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda as read?
I'll make that motion.
Brian makes a motion to approve the consent agenda as read. Is there a second?
Second.
Todd seconds. All in favor of the approving consent agenda, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Approval of claims and payroll.
We have one pre-written claim listing this evening. It's dated September 30, 2016. In the amount of $764,343.35. Our regular claim listing is dated October 10, 2016, in the amount of $109,470.17. We have three payrolls this evening. The first is dated September 2, 2016, in the amount of $396,607.13. The second is dated September 16, 2016, in the amount of $400,261.69. And the third is dated September 30, 2016, in the amount of $395,597.76. I submit these claims and payroll for you.
Is there any questions on the claims and payrolls? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the claims and payrolls as presented?
I'll make that motion.
Tom makes the motion to approve. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any seconds? All in favor of approving the claims and payrolls as read, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Financial.
Okay. You have a reconciled bank statement and a monthly financial report of funds for the month of September 2016. In summary, our receipts and disbursements for that month are total receipts $1,560,448.83, and the total disbursements for that same month, $2,363,130.43.
Any questions on the financial report? Hearing none, we'll move to old business. Update on the Akron Elementary School project.
I know we've got a couple of things to look at tonight, so which one do you want to take first, Brandon, the report or the...
the detention fund?
We can do the report first. Go ahead and do that, so. Changed a lot of last 4 weeks for you guys. So a few things we've completed since last time we were here. We've completed foundations in the area B. We've been working on area B and D slab on grade. We completed our last slab pour of area D, the classroom area, last Friday. We've started setting structural steel. We set the gym joists, 66-foot long joists. Set those about a week and a half ago. We've set interior columns, joists of D area, which is the classroom area. Today we finished setting the joists along the east or west side of the classroom also. Next thing to do is finish all of our CMU in area B. We've started setting the mezzanine steel, which on top of that goes air handlers, things like that. So we're continuing in the cafeteria area right now with CMU, taking those walls up. We had a beam signing last week for all the kids down there. I don't know if anybody's seen pictures or anything. So had a beam set out by the pole barn that we had painted. All the kids got to come out and sign it. Art teacher came and did a whole mural in the middle of it. So kids love that. And they sectioned off by classroom, so each one got a chance to come out and sign it. So, but we didn't have time. We had to take that beam. I didn't get a chance to get Rochester paper out there to watch it go up, because first thing the next morning we had to get that in place so we could continue our wall. So that is actually in place now. I know Cassie was out today, saw some took some pictures of that. So we've completed area D underground plumbing rough end, so we've got a lot of restrooms and everything around that kindergarten wing and some, you know, other classroom area that has restrooms there. That's all done. Did all the underground electrical through there. So next step is getting into the area C, which is the admin area. We're going to start building those foundations. We're trying to work our way out of the building so we don't cut anything off right now. So we're hopes to have area B, which is gym, cafeteria, kitchen area. We should be done with that CMU hopefully in the next couple of weeks. We'll have the classroom area walls all up. We're going to start roofing here in the next few weeks, so gym will be first. We'll jump right over into above the mezzanine, get all that dried in, so, and then continue on all interior finishes hopefully soon after that. So it's going to get real busy here in the next 4 weeks. So any questions?
Do you have any questions?
This is a long schedule.
We're behind on exterior, and we're working with a masonry contractor right now how to catch time up. And Jim and I are looking through everything interior-wise, where can we save time to catch that up. Main thing right now is get it enclosed and dried so we can start doing all the interior build-out, because it's going to get cold before too long. So Jim and I harp at them every day. Hurry up so we can get in close. We can have a place to work here a few months when it gets cold. So we started with the hardest area, the gym area, the mezzanine and all that is the hardest area, but that's the whole heart of the project. That's where all the mechanical and electrical comes from. So we're pushing them to get it done quicker. So.
Okay. You want to talk to us now about the detention area?
Yes. Yeah, we've got roughly four different pricings for the detention area on things to do with the bottom of that pond, because many of you know it holds water right now. The day after we dug it, there's been water, 6 inches of water. Per plans, basically what we're supposed to do is just put 6 inches of topsoil in and seed it. Well, there's going to be an issue because it's just going to turn to mud and it can't maintain that. So Commonwealth Engineering went through and came up with a few different options. Option A was doing a concrete bottom in it, changing the grade, pouring 2 foot wings on each side, a 2 foot bottom to help get the water out of there. Next option was doing riprap, still changing the grades, but doing some riprap rock down through the bottom.
And then there was an option to do basically native seeding throughout the bottom. So it'd be plants that indigenous to the area that would grow. The cost on these items, you know, spread, vary. I mean, from concrete, I believe, is $30,000. You guys have pricing on all that. Do we want to talk about the dollars now, or do we want to get into the meats and potatoes of it?
Well, let's talk about what costs.
And, you know, the concrete option, we've looked at it numerous times on, is that really a good option? You know, the pricing we have is first pricing from the contractors, and most of you guys know in construction, the first price you get from them right now for change orders is not their best price. So, you know, bad thing about this is we asked them to do three different pricing, and to try to knock down pricing on each one right now would be hitting their head against the wall. So we'd like to figure out a direction that the board wants to go, so then we can work with that contractor to get that price down. Now, concrete being the most expensive, you know, it should get all the water out of there, but my fear is the way the water table is, you're gonna have water perched underneath it. So 5 years from now, 10 years from now, all the freeze thaws, it is gonna break up. Don't know how much, if just control joints will control that, but eventually it's gonna turn into you're spraying it kind of like you would riprap, is our opinion. And for the price that you pay to get concrete, it's not worth in 5-10 years to have to maintain it like you would riprap. You know, riprap cost was about half of the concrete. So, but with that, we'll have to come spraying to maintain it, so you don't have cattails and everything growing in it and actually make it look right. So, one thing I would like to look at after the meeting is, I asked our dirt contractor, G&G, to come, that maybe an ulterior or alternate option to doing this and what cost savings might be. We can talk about that afterwards, which is kind of something that they haven't planned on yet, but things talking with G&G that we could maybe do, help save money and still get the same type of option in it, because we also had a pricing to fence all the way around the pond, which is about $13,000, because we would basically have about 800 lineal feet of fencing around that. Now, we just got that pricing in the last week, so we have not got the whole breakdown from the contractor of what's going in that, so hopefully we can get that pricing come down too. But if you're spending $13,000 on a fence and $30,000 on concrete, you're not going to be happy in 5 years when that concrete's all broke up and you're spraying it. So, you know, I think the best option would be your riprap and keep it treated, or you can put it in as plans call and then wait and see what it does. But it's always going to have water in it. It's just the way the water table is. It's never got out of there. So, you know, building it up with 6 inches of topsoil, it's just going to be 6 inches of mud in the bottom.
Now, Brandon, when you say as the plans call for, so what is it spec for?
Basically, the plans call for right now, we add 6 inches of topsoil on the sides and the bottom, and then it all gets seeded. So per plans, we owe that per original bid to do that. Now, if we do that, I'm the one that opened up this can of worms when we dug this pond, because the day after we dug it, we had 6 inches of water in there. And I knew that it's not going to dry up because of the way the water's perching in it, that it's not going to be dry. So the design team wanted to leave it and see what it did over the summer months, and we haven't had less than 6 inches of water in it the whole time. So, you know, per plans right now, if you don't do anything, it's add 6 inches of topsoil and seed it and done. So.
And you think that just is going to be a bloody?
It's going to be a bloody mess. You're not going to have 6 inches of topsoil in the bottom of it. Nothing's going to grow. You know, when they go to mow anything, if they get too close, it's going to be soggy. It might not look soggy on the bank, but I mean, it's going to be wet. You know, we're going to have mowers hung up, and you know, then it gets back into regrading it all and fixing seeding and things like that. So whole reason why I brought this up in, you know, early June, July, but you won't be happy if we just do what we do on the plan fee stuff, basically, so.
What if, instead of giving that contractor that option, hey, give us a better price, or are we able to just call in somebody else, say, hey, give me your quote on this?
Yes, after, we would have to complete it the way we're supposed to, and then you'd have to do that after. So we would have to get it to where we're supposed to. I mean, if you want it done, we can have them put the topsoil in, walk away with that area. You don't want to do anything until you get substantial completion, because we still have warranties, things like that. You would have to wait until you get a substantial completion to then take it over. Or contractors will say, well, you went over my work, you voided my warranty, I'm not warranting that issue, that area, is my fear. I'm not talking about our dirt contractor.
Right. I'd hate to see dirt thrown in there and grass seed thrown in there, and we're going to rip it all back out.
No. I mean, it would not make sense to put that.
No.
Put the bottom 6 inches. Right. I mean, the banks, that makes sense, and seed the banks, you know.
So could there be a credit there from that contractor that
could
help
be,
us?
I mean, but.
That you're only credits, talking.
Yeah. Credits are not
very, very little.
If you want Carrie to talk, one thing Carrie and I talked today, this is Carrie with G&G, our dirt contractor out there. One thing we talked about today is, does it even make sense to change the banks? Because basically the way the bank comes down, Commonwealth has changed the way it is to slope it to give it a narrower basin, basically, of it. Go from being 10 feet wide to 6 foot wide. Well, does it even make sense to do that? Because in order to do that and even build that up with your topsoil in there, we have to dewater it all. You got to have a pump in there the entire time to keep it dry to even do that. So does it even make sense to change the grades? You know, does it make sense to just leave the grades as it is, you know, keep it 10 feet wide, you know, and then you can start building stone in there. You know, they want fabric under the riprap. 3-4 years from now, there's going to be enough silt in between on top of the fabric that it's going to start to grow. So fabric doesn't really make sense to me to put in, because you're going to get stuff in between the rocks and it's going to grow anyways. So Carrie, I asked him, he was going to look at if we basically didn't change the grades and just started to do riprap stone through there, what that ended up being.
Well, a couple things I guess I want to back up and talk a little bit about. Just some of the reason the water holds there is the invert of the tile that we laid all the way to the north ditch is 6 inches up from the bottom. So obviously if the tile, the invert of the tile is 6 inches up, that's where your water level is going to sink. So what we've done at this point is we've cut it -6 inches because we had to put 6 inches of topsoil underneath or in the bottom of that pond so it could sink. But just the groundwater and all the perched water there, it just never, I mean, you guys can tell, we were digging the tile up through there. I mean, we were through groundwater all the way. But so whatever the invert of that tile is, your water is never going to go below that. You know, we thought maybe this summer when things dry out a little bit, it might, but it didn't really ever happen. So, you know, the invert of the outfall at pipe, you know, that's going to set what the groundwater level is in the bottom of the pond. So that's probably not going to change. The other issue as far as going back to, I guess, suggestions that I would be concerned about on the concrete side is we've got some soil issues in the bottom of that. There's some unsuitable soils, the poor concrete down in there. I mean, you're just not going to be happy with it in a few years. I'm not saying we couldn't make it work, but it's not going to last. That I think doing something in riprap is going to be riprap, or, you know, if that's too industrial looking for you, you know, we can use like a glacier stone or a field stone. You know, some little browns and blue rocks, which it is more expensive, but, you know, just depends on what you're looking for. If you're going to fence it off and keep the kids out of it anyhow, I mean, I don't know that it's worth the money. That's more of a dollar cents thing. But and then the other thing, if we do the riprap, I agree with him from a standpoint that I can't see putting that fabric underneath there just because all your stormwater is going into that it's going to silt in, and then pretty soon you're going to have rocks on top of the fabric in the stone anyhow. So I don't know that you're really helping yourself by putting that fabric down. It'd be a short window. If it was mine, what I would do
Right now, it's 6 inches. There is 6 inches of water standing there, but the one thing that that does do for us during the time of construction, that acts as a sediment basin as far as the storm water that is going into that pond. If there's any sediment being carried in the storm pipes or runoff, it has a place to settle before it would start chasing down the pipe to the ditch. So I know it's not maybe the most sightly looking spot on the site right now as far as from a looking perspective, but if we leaving it down to 6 inches for the remainder of the job, I think is, you know, something that the soil erosion people would probably prefer, just because it does act as a sediment trap for that sediment before it would hit on down the pipe to the ditch. You know, and at the end of the project, you know, if they decide you want to do some sort of riprap, if you wanted to riprap, what I would do, instead of changing the elevations in the bottom of the ditch, just the elevation that's there, we'd remove the additional 4 to 6 inches, whatever we needed to get the depth of riprap that we need, because we pretty much want the riprap to end up, the top of the riprap ending up at the invert of your pipe. So we have to remove another 4 to 6 inches out of there to get the full 12 inches of riprap in there. You know, and it could be we didn't have to use something as large as riprap, but you have a couple pretty large pipes coming into there, an 18, a 12, or 18, a 15, 24. So, I mean, they're pretty good sized pipes, so there's some valuable water that'd be good to have that, you know, 4 to 6 inch size is what a piece of riprap is. So, but just lay that whole bottom in riprap, and I'm not saying there's not going to be water running between the stones to get to that other end, because there's only, it's 160 feet long, and there's only 7/10 of fall, so that's less than 0.5%, so that's 6 inches. You know, so you're only talking about, you know, about 3.5/10 or 4 inches in 100 feet. So, I mean, it's not a lot of slope there that is pretty flat. So there's going to be some water that lays in there. So I think the best thing you can do is somewhat just mask it with some riprap on top, just because it's never going to go away, because the invert of the tile going out is as low as the water's ever going to get. So, you know, and I think depending, I mean, I'm happy to work with them. There would be some cost savings from a standpoint from what we've priced currently because of all the grade changing to just riprap the whole bottom compared to what's been priced. So, you know, I think to me it's kind of a win-win situation to kind of head that route, kind of leave it with a sediment basin here during the construction at the end of it, then riprap the bottom, whether that's part of this contract or whether it's, you know, a local, you know, one of the guys there in Akron or whatever else would like to do it at the end of the project. So, as far as the credit of what work, I mean, it is pretty minimal. I mean, the grade's all there, maybe just the amount of putting that 6 inches of topsoil on the bottom, but there'd be a few bucks there. You know.
A few bucks?
Yes, but it's about 3,400 square feet, something like that. So
that's been funny. A few bucks for me is $2.
The riprap, you're talking, you're saying 12 inches? You're going to dig down and put 12 inches
right in. Right now the grade's minus 6 inches, so I would suggest that we would go on down another 4 to 6 to where we can get a total of 12 inches of stone in there, just because of the water coming out of those storm pipes. We want to make sure there's enough underneath there that's not going to like blow through the stone and cause it to start to erode underneath the rock.
And you still think with 12 inches we'll probably, and that's not thick enough, I guess we're still going to have issues with cattails and weeds coming up.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, especially over time. You know, that, you know, at the beginning you may not.
Right.
But, you know, over time, you know, all those seed pods, everything's gonna get carried by that, yeah, by the storm water down into there, so it's just a collection point. I mean, the stuff all settles at the low spot, so.
So it wouldn't matter going thicker either, probably.
No, I mean, I think the thing that would help is if there's a way that you could, you know, if, and I don't know where you're at on the, we can't really raise the bottom of the pond because the incoming pipe is only 7/10 above the outgoing pipe.
Right.
So it's not like we can just say, well, let's just fill the pond in. Well, the storm pipe's already in, and it's laid almost flat all the way around the north side and the east side of the building, that we couldn't, those elevations couldn't be changed because we're going clear around the south side of the building to catch some stuff. So, I mean, there's really nothing wrong with the design. I think it's just this groundwater, something that nobody expected was going to be this intense, that they thought once we kind of got it open and it dry out a little bit, but it just keeps running.
Right.
Could there be some type of a, from the riprap to where they could mow the bank, some type of a change, something put in there that they could mow right down to the riprap, but not be all jagged and...
Oh, it just have like an edging or something?
Some type of an edging or something.
Oh, yeah, you can do something. I mean, it, you know, it just depends on our weather, you know, you just, you round up that edge right up against the riprap. I mean,
yeah.
You know, just depends on what you're looking at, you know. Of course, you can do some sort of edging. You know, I'd probably want it to be something substantial, not just little metal edgings or something, but you could do something, but I mean, round up pretty cheap.
Yeah, that's true.
Probably wouldn't be feasible. I was thinking, Kerry, what if a guy come in there with tile hooked into the inlets and tiled it with perf tile?
Right. Well, the problem is the outlet pipe elevation, where the pipe that's going all the way to the ditch, I mean, it's in the bottom of the pond, so all your tiles are tying into that same tile. So
yeah.
That bottom elevation or where the water's going to come to, whether you add tile or out, it all comes back to that outlet elevation, and it is where it is, that 873,
84. Well, what, we got two tile coming in the tiles?
Yep.
I was thinking hooking directly onto them and tying them directly into the outlet tile.
Well, the bad thing is...
And then covering that all with like 5 C's. So we're 2 foot deep with 5 C's. And then in the middle of our perf tile, come up with a riser to catch the water, and then we might even be able to, over the 5 C's, put our paper down and seed a couple inches and just have a nice little circle riser spot.
I guess the only thing, I don't know what the design was on the stormwater. I was assuming the basin was dug for a reason to satisfy some stormwater. From your pre-development to your post-development stormwater calculations, you had to hold so many cubic foot of water. Well, you know, that's based upon the width of that pond at the bottom. All of a sudden, you start putting the tile in there, fill it with stone. Granted, there's void, so there is some capacity there, but not like just open ground.
Right.
That all of a sudden, your cubic foot of storage is dwindling.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is, I guess I like the idea of that pipe being open between the outlet and the incoming pipe, because worst case, you want it to fill the pond and flood around the grass versus backed up roof drains or something in the building, that you want to have an emergency relief that it can get out of the system and be able to go somewhere.
And you come in with an 18 and a 24, and it's 18 leaving the pond, and then it steps up to a 24.
So it could be if we got a major down.
Yeah, it's designed to, well, I wasn't a designer, but the outgoing pipe is smaller than the pipes that are coming in, that it was designed to hold some water and then release it at a slower rate than what it's coming in.
So like you said, we probably would have thought riprap's probably going to. I was just thinking maybe it would solve our weed problem if we could get
There's no doubt if you can get it up out of the water, that would get to where you could mow it. The problem is we've got inverts that are so close together and we're losing capacity. So I mean, I guess we could look at I still think the riprap is going to be the best solution. You know, shooting that little bit of Roundup once or twice a year, that's not like the rules.
And if it's 12 inches, I don't think it's going to be horrendous.
And the slopes on the bank, I'm thinking they're about a 6-to-1 slope on that. So it's a mobile slope that you can go down the hill and turn and come back up. It's not like you're doing one cheek sneak the whole way down. So.
Okay.
So what do you think? The idea of just leaving it right now and then...
That's what I think. Yeah, let's just leave it and then we're all finished.
We'll let the river out.
I think go with the
way it sounds.
Do what it's doing.
Sounds like the best option.
Yeah.
So you think we ought to go ahead and do the fence, or at least the one side, the west side?
Well, we've already got the fence in there.
Yeah.
The fence is already in the budget, right?
No.
No, it's not.
Let's not fence it now. We just got a little section on the south end, don't we?
Yeah, you don't. Fences was around the playground. You had some fence around the playground, but actual around the detention pond, there's no fence.
Right.
And that cost came in around $13,000, and that's roughly 800 lineal feet of fence all the way around the top of the fence with a couple gates in it, so you can get down there and mow. Now, we haven't talked to the contractor, got his whole breakdown on that, but right now that's where that price is. So
I know riprap sharp, and will kids get hurt down if they got down in there?
I mean,
riprap,
if,
yeah.
if you're not going to fence it, I would be more apt to put a glacier stone, just because it's round stone.
Right.
Is that a riprap? I mean, it's a crushed stone. So, I mean, you know, there's it's not like it's
right.
It's razors, but, you know, I put a fence. I think we've all had a few skid knees on the corner.
Clubs torn, scraped knees, yeah. We'd have to put a fence around, definitely.
You know,
Do we have to use that contractor when it comes to the fence? Because that was not even in the contract at all, right?
No, it was not.
No, and then the contractor you asked about it said, well, that's $13,000.
Right.
Which you know and I know that that's way too much.
Yes.
Yeah, but we can bid that, right?
Right.
Yeah,
you can go out and get
it. You can go out
and bid on that fence.
That's just to give you an idea.
Yeah, that's just
right
now.
All right.
It sounds like you know the direction you're going.
Personally, I would like to see that west side be fenced since the kids are out there playing.
Oh, we have snow fence all of it. We've put up a 4-foot snow fence around it. Basically, the west or the south side of it and the west side of it has protection around it, so you can't get in there. I have to get in there every other day to get balls.
How tall of a fence are you talking we should put in there?
They designed a 6-inch-foot chain link fence, basically, and go all the way around, is what our proposal request was for.
And we're talking about putting that in after the work's finished?
Right. Yeah, we can say that we're not moving forward with that PR, either the fence one nor the detention ponds at all. We can just leave it as base bid, or, you know, not put 6 inches topsoil on the bottom, but, you know, just dress up the sides, leave the 6 inches topsoil out of the bottom, and afterwards.
Yep, sounds good.
I would suggest that you don't have us finish as far as put it to where we're supposed to.
Because
all the dirt we put in there, we're going to have to dig right back out.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's only going to cost you more money.
Right.
I think we just leave it like it is right now.
I mean, technically, if you do the side right now, a lot of it's going to end up in the bottom anyway.
Well, we probably wouldn't do anything right now until springtime anyway.
Yeah.
So.
You've done some retention ponds probably for other schools.
Mm-hmm.
What have they done with...
It's riprap at the bottom. I mean, you definitely have a high groundwater, you know.
Yeah, a little different situation.
You know, and I know we were already really deep to get that tile all the way to the north, so it's not like the only thing you possibly could have done if the tile was lower, the invert of the outlet was lower, then the bottom of the pond could have still been where it was, and you could have had tiles like you talked about around the bottom and drain the bottom of it. But to lay that 18-inch tile, half a mile up to the ditch, you know, all those extra dollars, I think you could buy Roundup for now for the next 4 years. So I'm not saying it was designed wrong. It's just I think that the groundwater is just a lot higher than anybody thought it was going to be.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Appreciate it. All right, we'll move to item 2 through. Approve the addition to the school board policy of extracurricular participation by homeschool students.
Right. Last month I brought to you an addition to school board policy on extracurricular participation by homeschool students. We went through that briefly.
Anybody have any questions on that? Or?
Nope.
No?
I make a motion to approve the addition to the school board policy of extracurricular participation.
Brian makes a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Tom seconds. All in favor of approving the addition to the extracurricular participation by homeschooled students, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Is there any other form of business?
That is it.
New business.
Okay.
Report on the grant funding for the functional life skills class and special education program at the Minton Elementary.
I'd like to introduce to you Kathy Olson. Kathy is one of our special needs teachers here at Mentone. She has received 2 or 3 grants during the last year that she's done some pretty nice things in her classroom that she'd like to share with you. So I'm going to switch her over. You are computer number 2. And then we'll go. Okay.
I just want to tell you a little bit about my classroom. I've been here since 2003 at Valley, teaching special education. My students have changed drastically over the years. When I first started out here, it was a pretty easy job, and my students could access the curriculum. Over the past 5 or 6 years, I have students coming in with significant health needs and unlimited physical abilities. So to get the curriculum adapted to them has changed, and that's why I've been doing a lot of grants and fundraising for my classroom. Our first little guy here, his name is Sean. His mom said I could share anything that I would like to share about him. He's our most popular student here at Mentone Elementary. He's Mr. Doms' buddy. Mr. Doms isn't here tonight to tell you that, but he'll tell you this is one of his favorite kiddos. Sean is in the fourth grade this year. Don't let his size fool you. He's a little guy. But we have to do a lot of things to keep him actively entertained in the classroom. He's a great kid and a great student here, but he needs a little bit different curriculum than the rest of the students in our building. There's another one of our students. We do a lot of hands-on projects in our room. We also have an area in the room where we utilize teach boxes, and we have hands-on activities for students. And you can see to the right of that student, there are some activities there. Those are mostly teacher-created. I and my aides have created these over the years for hands-on activities for students for a different way other than textbooks to access the curriculum here at school. The big grant that we got this year, we needed to purchase some new swings for our classroom. In a few minutes, you'll see a bigger picture of this swing. About 6 years ago, I got this swing purchased for our school. It sits in the middle of my classroom on the back side. As you can see in the first picture, little Sean man, the swing was getting down to where when he was trying to swing, it's dragging, and he can't. He uses the swing for physical therapy. He has limited walking abilities. He is not in a wheelchair, but it is difficult for him to get around the school building. And this is another way for him to do physical therapy. The second picture, you can see his new swing. Like I said, the first picture is a little deceiving. There's a shadow there. His bottom was dragging in that swing. The second picture, you'll see again the full swing in a few minutes. I've got him about 2 notches up. He's not dragging anymore. And in a few minutes, you'll get to watch a video of how he uses this equipment in my room. This is the second swing that we bought with the grant money. This was the little girl that you saw a few minutes ago working at the table. This gives her an opportunity to be in a swing. She could not be in a swing by herself like Sean could. The swing has lap belt, leg restraints, and chest restraints so that she can swing independently and be safe while she's in that swing. For this student, every 2 hours, we need to change her positioning. We do not leave her in her wheelchair all day. Before I got this swing, the two things that I could do is change the position of her wheelchair or lay her down on the floor where she could stretch out. Now we have a third option, and she absolutely loves it. I did not ask permission to share her face. That's why you don't see her face. But she's looking off to the left. Her iPad sits over there, and she listens to stories and songs that are self-generated on the iPad, so no one has to turn the pages for her. And that's an independent activity that she can do in my classroom by herself. And this is my video, Sean. This was in his old swing, but it just gives you an idea of how much fun this little guy has and how that's really working his legs as he's swinging around. And his big cheesy smile. And yeah, he did kick that, so, but he's okay. He loves the swing. And that's just another form of physical therapy for him. I have a lot of students that have physical therapy and need occupational therapy. The therapists come to our school once a week from Warsaw. You're seeing the top part of the swing now where I showed you. I can lift his swing 2 more notches for him to be able to swing just like a normal child outside on the playground would be able to have access to that, and he can have it inside. I have other students that also use the swings. It's not just for physical therapy. The two little guys that you see in the swings in these pictures, one student has an emotional disability and the other student has autism. We're fighting with our autism population. It's on the rise again. I have 8 students at Mentone this year that have autism. Their sensory needs, they get agitated, they need breaks, they get angry. Our students with emotional disabilities also have those kind of things going on. This is a time they can come in the room, take 5 minutes in the swing, talk out whatever problems they're dealing with, and then they go back to the classroom. These two little guys are not in my classroom for a majority of the day. They just come down for a break time and they utilize those swings. Okay, grant dollars. Last year, the Lake Area Autism Network gave me $140 to take my students to Magical Meadows. We took 3 trips last year to Magical Meadows. Again, Sean Mann's the star here in this picture. If you don't know anything about Magical Meadows, it is the most wonderful place to take students. I had students that we put on the horses that really didn't talk a whole lot at school that started talking, started repeating the commands that they were giving them, talking to the horse, and it was just amazing to see that. We also linked with our high school students. My daughter is in this picture, the FFA students. A couple of them came on our trips with us. We picked different students each time, and they linked in and helped these kids and work through therapy time. So that was the Lake Area Autism Network. This year I started a new, I have 2 classes that I do social skills with. One is for just students that have behavioral difficulties here at school, and then the other one is for students with autism. I bought a new program with the Keys Grant last year. It was $940 and it's called Superhero Social Skills. Basically what the program is, a different way to teach social skills and teach the kids that they're superheroes. I can't share a lot about it because we just started it. I'm only in the 2nd unit right now, but the kids really like it and enjoy it. It came with a comic strip. It came with video clips that I can show. It came with new game ideas. Some of my kids end up being in social skills the entire time they're with me in the elementary years, so it gets a little bit old trying to come up with new materials for them. So that's a new program this year. And then the swings. I started this as a generouschoose.org project, and we raised $410.60. I will have Ms. Jensen share a little bit about how she helped me finish up this year.
All right, so when Ms. Olson came to me looking for ways to come up with some of the money, I believe at the moment you had about $70 come in, but we were still looking for about $370. I think when you brought the project to me, we were looking at if we didn't get the funds in 2 to 3 weeks, somewhere in that time frame, the project was going to close and Ms. Olson wouldn't get her funds. Unfortunately, that takes out a lot of different funding options. Even the quickest grant funders have a turnaround time of about 3 months, 2 to 3 months. So we needed to look for something that was even more localized than some of our really good grant funders. I had to start looking at some of the smaller organizations that I knew funded some things in my hometown, and we came up with the acronym Mentone Kiwanis. I called Mr. Russ Rehart, and he invited both of us to come enjoy a meal with the Mentone and Akron Kiwanis at a meeting that they happened to be having the next Monday night, which was very serendipitous. And we went and shared a meal with them and presented much of the same information that you all have just seen about the project. And at the end of the night, they told us that we should hear back from them in a week. That timeline was very sped up by the time that I think Ms. Olson got home. She had a donation from the Kiwanis and also from the Creightons. So the swings, we also got the swings. I think you got one of them the week after, and then within a month, I think you had the other one. So the turnaround time on that, for her to be able to use the items that she needed, was very, very quick. And we've been able to put together thank you packages for them, as per Donors Choose has us do. And then we also invited them to be here tonight. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like they can come. But that's kind of how we funded an unusual project.
Yes. I started the project last year. They give you about 3 to 4 months to finish your project, and it was just getting there towards the end, and I really wanted these swings for these kids, and we use them every day in my classroom, and the kids love them. I also want to mention the Creighton family. They were at the Mentone Akron Kiwanis meeting. They donated part of the funds. They kind of split it. Deb Girdler, our speech therapist here at Mentone, also donated. And then we had a private donor that I don't know who that person is, just on the web. He donated to the project. So this was a unique way for us to get some funding for the kids for some extra equipment. You know, the school corporation, 6 years ago when they bought that swing set for me, that's a $15,000 swing. It will last the entire time I'm here. It will last beyond me. There are other swings that we have with it. We just need something more as these students get larger and they still need access to this equipment. So we needed some other things, and they're fairly expensive to purchase. I also believe in that my class needs to work on projects and generate their own funds. So as well as grant funding, we also recycle cell phones and we work on class projects. Last year we raised $75 on our own in our classroom doing projects. The one example I have up there is we made notebooks, just the simple ones you can go and buy at the store, and we happened to put a Christmas design on them. We had a bake sale in-house. We did a couple other projects last year. I'm a firm believer in that the students also need to help and raise money for the things that we need for our classroom. And then the fundraising activities, one of the things that we did as a class is we ordered Bourbon Street pizza, and it tied into a math unit that we had been working on where we were working with a menu and we were talking about. So I try to tie these things into our community and into the curriculum so that the kids, it's not just about eating pizza, it just wasn't about making money. It's like, now what can we do with the money that we earn for our classroom? I also, last year, got an idea. This was from money that we raised as a group. I made a sensory board for our classroom. It's just a simple thing. The kids with autism that come in my room love this sensory board this year. It's brand new. It's a simple thing just to put on the wall. There's different things. You can see the texture on the right side. There's some sandpaper there. There's some soft material. There's, in the middle, you can kind of see a box with a red button on it. They push that. The other day, some student recorded Mrs. Olson Rocks on there. That was really great. At the beginning of the year, there was just different messages that the kids could push. There's lights on there. Really dark by the telephone is a calculator. There's just different things they can touch and feel. And throughout the year, we'll change that board up and put. Some of the things are Velcroed on. Some of them are just tacked on. I can take them off and change that out for the students. So our total funds from grants last year and this year was $1,565.60. Of outside community support through grants to help students access the curriculum and for the needs at school that have to be met in a non-traditional manner. It was kind of neat that our discussion tonight, we talked about Riley's kids. I say about half of my students are Riley's kids. It was also kind of neat that Mr. Conley said, we need to meet the needs of all our students. And that's what we're trying to do here at Mentone. So I thank you for inviting me tonight and letting me share about the grants and the fundraising we've been doing.
Good job, Greg.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good job.
Okay, we move to item 2, approval of donation from the Kosciuszko County REMC.
We'd like to encourage the board to approve a donation from Kosciuszko REMC. It's to the high school, and that donation will be used to plant trees in the softball field.
Is there a motion to approve the donation?
I'll make the motion.
Tom makes a motion to approve the donation. There's a
second.
Todd seconds. All in favor of approving the donation from the Kosciuszko County RMC, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Item 3, approval of donation from the Teachers Credit Union.
Would also like to ask the board to accept a donation from the Teachers Credit Union. They, for the last probably 3 or 4 years, have served as a corporate sponsor of our Distinguished Alumni Dinner and Induction Day by making a donation of $1,000 to cover those costs. So we do appreciate their support, and we ask you to approve that.
Is there a motion to approve the donation from Teachers Credit Union?
Stan makes a motion, do I have a second?
Second.
Tom seconds, all in favor of approving the donation to Teachers Credit Union, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. Approval of the grant from the K-21 Health Foundation for the Tower Garden System.
Tom is going to present that one.
I want to go through the pictures here and take a look. These are different examples of tower gardens that we're going to try to put in some classrooms within the school corporation. You see the basically the advantages is it does not take up the square footage that the normal garden would when you've got things growing vertically. We want to go to the second slide there. This is a different type where I believe this is what we would be ordering because we'll be using the lights. We're not having these outside, so this is a different model. And then the next one is an example of really focusing some of these tower gardens. They focus on one plant, like the tomatoes or the lettuce. That's what has been suggested to us from another school that that has used this, and then the K-21 also really recommended that we really focus on one or two vegetables there. And then the fourth picture, that is, if you see in the bottom right-hand side of the picture there, there are about 15, I think, tower gardens there. That is the San Francisco Giants, their stadium. I believe the Central Division champions are playing there tonight. Thought I'd throw that in there. But you can see, and they're not the only ones. The Boston Red Sox are also doing something like this where they're growing this fresh produce and then using it within the concession stands and offering healthy food to folks that are at these games. So some of the benefits, they talk about the yields, they can increase by 30%. The plants grow about 3.5 times quicker. They use, according to the research, 98% less water because the water is recycled through the bottom. And then the vertical design, you're talking about 90% less space. And then the pollution and pests, those are less of a problem that you would have to deal with outside. There, if you Google this, these are becoming very popular out west, where people are using these on top of buildings, and these corporations are using all of these vegetables then within their cafeterias that they're feeding their employees with. So that's where we're coming from with this. We want to start this at the middle school and at the high school, and we want all of our buildings by the end of this year to have at least one of these gardens up and going. So this is something that K-21 wanted to sponsor, and they were excited that we came to them with this. What questions do you have?
So when you say each building has a garden, is that just two towers, three towers? What kind of towers is that?
But we want at least one tower. At the middle school, we're going to start off with the science classes so they can become the experts and then train in the other buildings. Okay. That's the process that we're looking at.
From there, right?
Yeah.
How many towers will they have?
I'd like one per science class.
Okay.
To so start off with.
Three.
Yeah. So, and then we really feel like the high school, the special needs class, this would be a good addition within their classroom, the teaching kids that side of food production and that we want to get our students to understand.
And this is another way to bring in the fresh gardens, yes, to the south, to the schools.
This says uses aeroponics to recycle 100% of the nutrients. What is aeroponics?
We're going to find out. Come on over to the middle school and Larry DeBose will teach us all.
But they do grow in dirt, right?
Yes. They're starter pods, and then they fit within the tube structure. There are places where those pods go, and then the water circulates through the entire tube. Yeah, it recycles
so it
back
and forth. To, yes, run off
pump.
Yeah.
Probably a little giant pump. They're on wheels, too. Like, Yep.
How much are those?
It depends on the model that you get. Ours are going to be more expensive with the
lights.
Yeah.
Looks like they're about $2,000 a piece, though. I'm told there are six, and we're getting three of them.
How tall are these things?
Well, some of them are 10 feet tall. Ours will not be that tall.
Right.
Yeah.
So we would ask the board.
I'm not a baseball person, but I think that was a slam from Mr. Kyle.
I'm just stating the obvious.
Cardinals, they still
I didn't know what time the Cardinals played tonight.
I'm not going to use this year, but you know.
Cardinals aren't in it anymore?
Just a second. What?
Aeroponics simply means that it's...
Just a second.
Aeroponics simply means that it's a growth from air and a mist of water.
Okay.
As opposed to soil.
Thank you.
I just Googled it. Thank you. She's absolutely right.
All right. Is there a motion to approve the K-21 Foundation grant? Todd makes that motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
And Brian seconds. All in favor of approving the K-21 Foundation grant for the Tower Garden System, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Approval of the grant from the K-21 Foundation for the Tippecanoe Valley High School weight room equipment and expansion.
This is kind of part two of the grant that we started, a process that we started a couple of years ago. We're asking that you approve a grant for two additional treadmills. We've got ellipticals listed here, but actually the need was a couple rowing machines is what folks had asked for. And you see the dollar amount there. What we also want to do is we want to remove the wall on the, it would be the west side that would, and we would expand the weight room into the receiving area. There's about 8 feet that we would like to move that over and redo that. That will allow us to put a TV up. We can have folks that want to maybe do like a small class of whether it's P90X, if they want to bring a group of people in there to work out in that area. It also gives us a little bit more room to buy four more pieces of equipment. K21 has they've been very good to us in terms of helping us increase the amount of equipment within the weight room and allowing us to have the community come in and use that equipment has been great. I know we've had some folks who they are staying down here and working out instead of staying in Warsaw or driving to Warsaw to the YMCA. They would rather stay local and work out in our weight room. And this is a great benefit, not only to the students and the staff, but it allows the community to come in during these hours. Right now we're working the Tuesday and Thursday, but as it gets colder, we will move it to Monday, Wednesday, Thursday for folks to come in and work out from 5 to 7. So we're just asking that you approve this recommendation for the grant.
I'll make a motion.
Is there a motion to approve that?
I'll make a motion.
Tom makes a motion to approve the K-21 grant for the weight rooms. Is there a second? Stand seconds. All in favor of approving the grant from the K-21 Foundation for the Tippecanoe Valley High School weight room and equipment and expansion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Okay, we'll move to the budget adoption.
You got that information?
No, I'm getting ready to pull it up. Yeah, because it's quiet. I think my battery is dead. It isn't close. The hearing was required by law for the capital projects fund was held on September the 12th, 2016. The purpose of this portion of the meeting is to adopt the capital projects fund. I will ask Mr. Boggs to present proof of publication of the notice to taxpayers of the capital projects fund plan exhibits A and B.
Okay, you can see the exhibit A.
Questions? No?
I'll entertain a motion to make the capital projects fund plan and exhibits A and B as part of the minutes of this meeting.
I'll make that motion.
Brian makes that motion, is there a second?
I'll second.
Todd seconds. All in favor of approving this motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Now we'll ask Mr. Boggs to read the resolution to adoption of 2017 capital project fund, exhibit C.
Okay. This resolution is adopted by the Board of Trustees of the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation of Kosciuszko and Fulton Counties, Indiana. Whereas the school capital projects fund has been established, and whereas the Board of Trustees is required under Indiana Code 20-46-6-5 to adopt a plan with respect to the capital projects fund, and whereas the Board of Trustees held a public hearing on the capital projects fund from the plan on the 12th day of September 2016 at the Mentone Elementary School, Mentone, Indiana. Therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Trustees that the plan for the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation for the years 2017 to 2019 is hereby incorporated by reference into this resolution and is adopted as the Board of Trustees' plan with respect to the School Capital Projects Fund. Be it further resolved that the Board of Trustees shall submit a certified copy of this resolution, including the adopted plan, to the Department of Local Government Finance as required by Indiana Code 21-40-8-8 for approval, adopted this 10th day of October 2016.
I will entertain a motion to adopt the resolution to adopt a plan for capital project funds and to publish a notice to taxpayers of adoption of the capital projects fund plan exhibit D. Is there a motion for that?
I'll make that motion.
Tom makes a motion. Is there a second? Stan seconds. All in favor of capital projects plan exhibit D, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. The hearing was required by law on the school bus plan. It was held on September 12, 2016 for the purpose of this portion of the meeting to adopt the school bus replacement plan, exhibit E. I will ask Mr. Boggs to present proof of publication of the notice to taxpayers of school bus replacement plan for the years 2017 through 2028, exhibits A and B.
And again, there are those exhibits that A and B.
I will entertain a motion to make these exhibits a part of the minutes of this meeting. Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Tom makes that motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All in favor of making this minutes of the meeting, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. I will ask Mr. Boggs to read the resolution to adopt the 2017 bus replacement plan, exhibit F.
This resolution is adopted by the Board of Trustees of the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation of Kosciuszko / Fulton Counties, Indiana. Whereas the school bus or a school bus replacement plan has been established, and whereas the Board of Trustees is required under Indiana Code 20-46-5 to adopt a plan with respect to a school bus replacement plan, and whereas the Board of Trustees held a public hearing on the plan on the 12th day of September 2016 at the Mentone Elementary School, Mentone, Indiana. Therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Trustees that the plan titled School Bus Replacement Plan for the years 2017 through 2028 is hereby incorporated by reference into this resolution. It is adopted as the Board of Trustees plan with respect to the School Bus Replacement Plan. Be it further resolved that the Board of Trustees shall submit a certified copy of this resolution, including the adopted plan, to the Department of Local Government Finance as required by Indiana Code 20-40-7 for approval, adopted this 10th day of October 2016.
I will now entertain a motion to adopt a resolution to adopt the year 2017 bus replacement plan. Is there a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Brian makes that motion. Do we have a second?
I'll stand second.
All in favor of adopting the resolution to adopt 2017 bus replacement plan, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. the budget adoption. The hearing was required by law on the budget and tax levies and tax rates was held on September 12, 2016, and the purpose of this meeting was to adopt the budget. I will call upon Mr. Boggs to read the resolution of appropriations, budget form number 4, Exhibit G.
Okay, so the ordinance or resolution for appropriation and tax rates. This is be it ordained by the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation that for the expenses of Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation for the year ending December 31, 2017, the sums herein specified are hereby appropriated and ordered set apart out of the several funds herein named and for the purposes herein specified, subject to the laws governing the same. Such sums herein appropriated shall be held to include all expenditures authorized to be made during the year, unless otherwise expressly stipulated and provided for by law. In addition, for the purpose of raising revenue to meet the necessary expenses of Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation, the property tax levies and property tax rates as herein specified are included herein. Budget Form 4B for all funds must be completed and submitted in the manner prescribed by the Department of Local Government Finance. The ordinance resolution shall be in full force and effect from and after its passage and approval by the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation. And you can see down here, we have listed each of the funds, the first being the general fund. The adopted budget is $15,555,790. Of course, there is no tax levy, no tax rate for the general fund. The debt service fund, the adopted budget is $2,632,967 with an adopted tax levy of $2,514,659 with the adopted tax rate of 54.96 cents. Capital projects, adopted budget $2,678,299, the adopted tax levy for the capital projects fund, $2,444,669, with the adopted tax rate at 53.43 cents. For transportation, the adopted budget is $1,880,580, with the adopted tax levy, $1,429,204, with an adopted tax rate of 31.23 cents. And then finally, the bus replacement plan. The adopted budget is $305,000. The adopted tax levy is $305,831, for an adopted tax rate of 6.68 cents. If you put all those together, you can see the total adopted budget is $23,052,636. The adopted tax levy is $694,363, with an adopted tax rate of $1.46 and 30 cents. That is.
At this time, I will entertain a motion to adopt the resolution for appropriations. Adopt.
Guess there isn't.
There isn't.
I can give you that motion then.
Is that a second?
I'll second.
Tom seconds. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
And then that takes us to the blanket.
Adopt the blanket resolution to reduce appropriations.
Okay, and I will read that for you. Reduction appropriation resolution. It says, whereas for the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation 2017 school budget, it is determined by the superintendent it is necessary to reduce the 2016 unobligated balances that will not be needed for the purposes for which appropriated. The superintendent has the authority to make reductions on budget form 4B. budget estimate, financial statement, proposed tax rate. Line two, in any fund to more accurately reflect necessary expenditures. It is further ordained or resolved that the superintendent has the authority to reduce the 2017 appropriations on budget form 4B, budget estimate, financial statement, proposed tax rate, line one, in any of the funds or amounts necessary to finalize the 2017 school budget for the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation. It is further ordained or resolved that the superintendent has the authority to adjust the operating balances on the budget form 4B, budget estimate, financial statement, proposed tax rate, line 11, in any of the funds to finalize the 2017 school budget for the Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation. It is further ordained that the superintendent has the authority to request specific tax rates to be levied for the 2017 debt service and or capital projects funds. And then finally, it is further ordained that in the 2017 debt service fund, an operating balance of $600,000 or more shall be maintained. Dated this 10th day of October 2016.
Do I have a motion to approve the blanket resolution to reduce appropriations?
I'll make that motion.
I make that motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second. All in favor of approving the resolution to reduce appropriations, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Is there any other new business?
Oh, we have.
What about our student representatives? What do you have to report to us?
All right, I'm going to let Cheyenne go first. She has a longer list than I do.
Longer list?
Definitely more attentive, I guess.
Well, recently we just had our College Girl Week at the high school, which was, I believe, the last week of September. And that allowed students to apply to select colleges for with a fee waiver of that application. And that was good for students, or seniors especially. Also within this College Go Week, we had a freshman day of service, which is where the freshman went somewhere in the community and volunteered somewhere or just helped out. The sophomores went on college visits to either Grace or Ivy Tech, and that was really good for them because, you know, it's starting to open their eyes to the college world. And the juniors and seniors went on a career fair day, which was in Rochester on, I believe, Friday. It opened their eyes to different colleges, maybe opportunities, and potential employers within the community. So that was a good opportunity for everyone, junior and senior-wise. Also within the week, on Friday, we had a remediation day and celebration day for the end of the 9 weeks for everyone to get their late assignments turned in and just celebrate everything we've went through for the 9 weeks.
Yeah, definitely more hard work going into things. October 28th, I wanted to bring notice that we're going to have a election forum. The electees will be coming to that forum. This gives them the opportunity to talk to the public. In political and economic studies, the class at the high school that I'm in, we have constructed different questions as to be a basis for the people running to really get their word out on the things they want to do, why they're a solid vote. So that'll be coming up October 28th. It starts at 7 o'clock. And I believe it's going to end at 10 o'clock. It all depends on how long the different questions are taking. But I just wanted to bring that to the public's attention so then everybody knew about it so they can make an appearance.
So that's for school board candidates, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you've got all six coming?
Good. So down at the Akron Community Center?
Yes, it is down at the Akron Community Center. We're going to have everything set up there. Who's our moderator?
Rita Price,
yes. Rita Price is going to be the moderator, so I look forward to hearing her. It's going to be a good time. So yeah, that's what's going on at the school.
Good. Have anything else?
I got another plug in this, but the 28th, isn't that when Akron's doing their open house festival? But it's over at 7, so you can go to that and then go to the school board forum. I've got two things.
It's the 27th?
It's a Thursday night.
That's what I was doing.
It's a Thursday night.
Yeah.
I thought it was a Thursday night. I just asked Alan. I didn't think ours was on Friday, but...
Well, thank you.
Okay, well, you can go to that on Thursday night, and Friday you can come to the Akron Elementary Fall Festival.
By the way, here's one of our nominees.
Here's another.
Anything else? If there is nothing else, thanks everybody for coming, and this meeting is adjourned.